Good evening. We're just going to enter into a time of worship, so if you'd like to stand, please join us.
Remember the day that you gave your life to Christ? One of the things that we love about the Apostle Paul is he never forgot the day that he was saved. He refers to it over and over again. He refers to himself as someone born out of time. And he says, one of the times he talked about being saved, he says that Jesus appeared to him, "For I am least of the apostles because I am not fit to be called an apostle because I persecuted the church of God. But by the grace of God, I am what I am." Great song to remind ourselves where we came from. Let's take a moment to remember where God brought us from and the glorious day that he's bringing us to, and then we'll pray together. Just ponder that for a moment. Thank you, God. Thank you, Lord, for loving us so much. Thank you, God, that there's no person among us who is so far that you cannot reach and bring to a place where they are healed, forgiven, saved, and has a future bright as everyone else. Thank you, God. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, welcome to Journey. We're so glad that you're here. Why don't you wave to someone and just say hi? And by the way, just why don't you stay seated, stay standing, because we're not gonna belabor this. We're here to worship God and hear the word. The only announcements I just bring to you is today is a very special day for missions, for world missions. Very special day for also Pastor Emily, who is going to be sharing the message this evening, and also is going to be sharing about her upcoming trip to actually her life that's going to be lived out in the Dominican Republic and as a missionary. Give you an opportunity not only to hear about it, but to contribute. There will be two offerings tonight. There will be an offering, as usual, right at the back table for tithes and offerings, and then around the corner there's a display that Emily has put together. So please give heartily. It's a big adventure, and we would really welcome as much as you would contribute. Also, those of you who are listening online, watching online, thank you for joining us. And there are ways of giving, both in your tithes and offerings, and also specifically to Pastor Emily. And it's easy to see on the web how you can identify that. So, other than that, just to let you know that there's no kids or youth ministries this coming Wednesday. And also, we are looking for lots of people to join in and help us with all things kids ministry and youth ministry and worship ministries and in serving. So step up to the plate. And finally, we're going to have communion in just a few moments. If you attend here, if you're just visiting here, if you're a believer in Jesus Christ, you're welcome to participate with us in communion. You don't have to be a member. We do ask if you're a believer in Jesus, a follower of Jesus, join in. We'll receive communion in just a few minutes, and if you don't have one of these cups, then let me know. I will bring it to you. Who? Anybody that did not? Okay, good. Let's continue in our worship to God.
Chosen, I am free. Oh, I am living for eternity. I'm free now, forever. You pick me up, turn me around. You set my feet on solid ground. I'm yours now, forever. And now nothing's gonna hold me back, and nothing's gonna hold me back, and nothing's gonna hold me back. My chains fell off, my heart was filled. I'm alive to live for you. I'm alive to live for you. Wash my sin and shame away. The slate is clean, a brand new day. I'm free now, forever. Now boldly I approach your throne to claim this crown through Christ my own. And yours now, forever. So now nothing's gonna hold. Nothing's gonna hold me back.
So thankful for the blood of Jesus. Yeah. I love the scripture in Ephesians chapter 1 where Paul talks about that. And he says, in him, through Jesus Christ, we have redemption, which is really to be bought back so that our relationship with God is restored. We have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins, in accordance with the riches of God's grace. Grace that he lavished on us. Okay, so God didn't just, you know, kind of pour out his grace. He lavished his grace on you and me. And so we're going to share communion together today. You have your communion cup. This is the time you can actually take your mask off or pull the mask down. And there's a little cellophane wrapper over the bread piece, and then a larger wrapper over the juice piece. I want to just grab the bread, and we're going to share it together here. Familiar scripture verse in 1 Corinthians chapter 11. Paul said, "For I received from the Lord what I also passed unto you. The Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, 'This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me.'" Let us eat the bread together. The same way after supper he took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me. For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes again. Let us drink the cup together. Thank you, God. Thank you, Jesus. Your blood is what washes away our sins, restores our relationship with our Father in heaven, and offers to us the promise of eternity with you. We praise your name. Let's sing the rest of that hymn together as we praise the Lord in response to what he's done for us. Join me one more time as we pray. Thank you, God, for the amazing blessing of salvation. Lord, we pray that the good news would never become the old news. Lord, that it wouldn't become so familiar that it loses the special place in our lives, in our minds, in our hearts. So help us even tonight by the power of the Holy Spirit as we just finish celebrating communion, Lord. This is one of the things that you told us to do until you come again. Thank you for this great blessing that we have. That reminds us, Jesus, that your blood was shed for the forgiveness of our sins. Your body was tortured on that cross so that we could have eternal life with you forever. So thank you, God. Thank you, God. We praise your name. There is nothing like your blood. So we give you praise in Jesus' name and all God's people. Zen, amen. You can have a seat. So Pastor Emily Lane has been around for a while, and it wasn't too long ago that we had the ordination service for her here at Journey. Very appropriate, very exciting that we get the privilege as a church to send her and support her in her missionary call. And so you get to hear tonight a little bit about her missionary call. And then she was gracious enough to agree to give the message. And so we've been in the book of James all summer, and tonight she brings it in for a landing. And so I'm just so happy, Emily, to have you sharing tonight. God bless you. It's going to be great.
Yeah. Check. All right. Well, yes, it's an honor and a privilege to be here to share two times. So first I'm going to start off by just sharing, I have some slides, just about the opportunity that I have to move to the Dominican Republic to be a full-time missionary. I'm the worship pastor here. You know I love worship. It is my near and dear to my heart. And so my mission in life, whether I'm here or whether I'm in the Dominican Republic or anywhere else, is for worship to happen, for God to be glorified, for him to be exalted. And so there's a mission for worship. There's a quote that I've used before and said before from John Piper. It says, missions exist because worship doesn't. And at first it's a little maybe confusing, like I have to really think about that one. But God's purpose for the world is that the earth would be filled with the knowledge and the glory of God. And for the sake of his glory, for worship all over the world, that's why we do missions. And so I've shared with some of the leaders and stuff before, but I have this crazy idea, goal. And if I could, my goal would be to eradicate missions, which is a little out there. But I want the world to know Jesus, to have a relationship with him, to love him, to worship him. That is my ultimate goal. So wherever he takes me, it's what I'm doing. So that's a little bit about my vision, and it lines right up with Jim and Renee Larson from our church, missionaries to the Dominican Republic. They do everyday ministries there. Their mission is to equip, empower, and encourage the leaders and the pastors in the Dominican Republic. So I'll be doing everything that they do. And I have committed for an initial year with them, and we'll see what God does after that. But I'm along for the ride. So a little bit about the Dominican Republic. It is in the Caribbean. It shares 2/3 of the island with Haiti. The population is 10.7 million people. And in the capital, Santo Domingo, where I will be, there's 4.5 to 5 million people. So a lot of people. And then the language is Spanish there. And then as far as religion goes, about 70% of people say they're Christian, with a large percentage of that, of those people being Catholic in their faith and their upbringing. And then, you know, 10, 20% maybe evangelical. 28% claim nothing. They're not following any kind of religion, anything like that. And then 2% have an other. So there is a big mission field there for people to come to know the Lord and to experience him. As far as everyday ministries goes, I do everything they do. So they have leaders of impact. They have a Deborah Generation for women. Women are the number one killer of women in the Dominican is domestic abuse. So there's definitely a need for ministry and healing for the women there. They have a Men of Integrity. I serve punch and cookies for that one. Then there's also Daughters of Hope, which is for young teen pregnant moms. Average age for a first mom in the Dominican is 14 to 16 years old. So they need to be ministered to and loved on as well. So the biggest thing that I feel like I've been able to do is my last couple years I've been there, I was able to help them get started a worship institute. And in that, it's kind of like our school of worship that I've done here, where we talk about our identity in Christ and who God has called us to be. We talk about praise and worship, and what does that mean? What does the Bible say? We look at the Mosaic Tabernacle, and how do we follow God into his presence? How do we take those steps closer to him, living that lifestyle of worship? So that's something that I've had my hand in a lot, and I love it. I've loved to see the students, they're challenged in their faith and their walk, and to see you know, their eyes being opened up, their hearts being opened up. It's amazing. I love it. And then there are short-term teams that come there. I know Pastor Hollis has brought some medical teams there. There's other teams that have done nights of prayer and worship and VBS and construction and community projects. So there's a lot to do, and there's a lot of people from our church that have gone and supported or just even financially, prayerfully supported everyday ministries. And lots of testimonies of what God has done, from salvation to healing. God is working there, and it's exciting. One other part of the ministry is Everyday Hope. This is their humanitarian side of it. So I get to help with Livestock for Life. I'm learning a lot about livestock. There's clean water projects, medical training, small business training, law enforcement training. There's a lot happening. There's a lot that they have their hands in, and I get to help be a part of all those different areas of ministry. As far as support to go, right now I'm at about 33% of my total needing to go. And I guess one bit of news I should let you know. So the plan was for me to go in October. However, with the state of the world, the date now is January, so I will be around for a couple more months at least. So I'm okay with that. It's good. A little sad, but I love being here. So I'm looking for prayer support. I need prayers all the time. I need to be covered in prayer, backed in prayer. So if you're interested in being that, being part of like an intercessory team for me, definitely let me know in the ministry there. Budget-wise, it's about $2,500 that I'm looking for support a month. So monthly supporters or one-time givers. If you are interested in partnering with me in the ministry that's happening in the Dominican, let me know. I would love to meet with you, answer any questions that you have. You can give me a call or flag me down at church sometime, and I would love to share my heart with you. And the last little thing is, at the end of this coming week, on the September 3rd through the 5th, I will be having a rummage sale in the basement here, so just an opportunity for people. And then just if you would like to connect with me, I have a Facebook page, Mission for Worship, a website, missionforworship.com. Email me, give me a call, or once again, flag me, and I'll come running. So that is the opportunity that I have. I'm excited to go, preparing to go. Also in the back, I do have prayer cards, so if you want to stick this on your fridge or in your Bible, just remember to pray. Commitment cards, a letter, and for kids, because I think it's important that we teach our kids about missionaries, I have a coloring page so they can fill it out and find out about the country that the missionaries are serving in and what they should be praying for. So it's all out in the back, and I'll be out there after service if you guys have questions. So, all right, time for the word. So we are in the last message in the series of James, which is the Faith That Works series. So we're going to be looking at James 5, 13 through 20 tonight. And like it's been said many times before, James is like a super practical book of the Bible. It is a how-to on Christian living. If you're going through something, a challenge, suffering, sickness, confrontation, you can probably find an answer in James for that. That's very practical to what you need. So one thing, when it comes to following Jesus, we all know that it is our personal commitment, it's our choice to follow Jesus. Just because you're in a family and you go to church, you grow up going to church, doesn't necessarily mean that you're following Jesus. You have to make that personal commitment. So even though it is a personal commitment, it's not an individual journey or venture. We're in this together as the body of Christ. So we are the church, we are the body, we are the bride of Christ, and it's us together. It's not us individually, it's us together that make up the church, the body, and we need each other. So 1 Corinthians 12, 26 to 27 talks about the body and how if one part is missing or not doing its part, the rest of the body suffers. So a hand can no longer serve its intended purpose once it's removed from the arm. If you just have a hand laying on the side, not connected to the arm, it can't serve the purpose that it was intended for. So we have to be connected. We have to be the body and work together. We have to do life together. So we're going to look at James 5 and look at what it means to do life together. What can we, yes, do individually, but then what can we also do together to walk out our faith with the Lord? So let's read James 5, 13 through 20. It will be on the screen. All right, so it says, is anyone among you in trouble? Let them pray. Is anyone happy? Let them sing songs of praise. Is anyone among you sick? Let them call the elders of the church to pray over them and anoint them with oil in the name of the Lord. And the prayer offered in faith will make the sick person well. The Lord will raise them up. If they have sinned, they will be forgiven. Therefore, confess your sins to each other and pray for each other so that you may be healed. The prayer of a righteous person is powerful and effective. Elijah was a human being even as we are. He prayed earnestly that it would not rain, and it did not rain on the land for 3.5 years. Again, he prayed, and the heavens gave rain, and the earth produced its crops. My brothers and sisters, if one of you should wander from the truth and someone should bring that person back, remember this. Whoever turns a sinner from the error of their way will save them from death and cover over a multitude of sins. There is a lot packed into those verses. So I'm going to attempt to go through all of it in a short amount of time. So the first thing that I noticed when I was reading through those scriptures is prayer is said a ton. In verses 13 through 18, prayer is mentioned every verse. So prayer is a theme here. Prayer is important. And then the other thing that stood out to me was there's a lot of instances in this section of scripture where we're confessing to one another, where we're in relationship. We're going after the one who has wandered from the faith. If there's anybody among us that's suffering or sick, we're praying, we're singing praise. So it's about being together and doing life together. So out of the gate, the first question is that they ask is very relatable, I think, to today. Is anyone among you suffering? Is anyone suffering hardship or in distress or in trouble? So I looked up what to suffer means in the dictionary, and it means to sustain injury, disadvantage, or loss, to undergo a penalty, to endure pain, disability, death, to undergo or feel pain or distress. And then I was like, okay, distress, what does that mean? Distress is to afflict with great pain, anxiety, or sorrow, trouble, worry, bother, to subject to pressure, stress, or strain. I feel like that is a list that a lot of us can relate to. It's very relatable to today, whether you're dealing with pain or anxiety or sorrow, or maybe you're just stressed. It's a part of life. It's things we go through. So has anybody been there? Anybody felt any of those things? I know I have. So it might be in the past. It might be currently that you're feeling those things, but it's very practical. It's speaking to us today. So we all have or are currently suffering in some regard, but right off the bat we get the answer, and the answer is to pray. If you're suffering, if you're anxious, if you're stressed, pray. That's what we are to do. So the first thing is we are called to pray. And I think this should be our first response. I think sometimes, I feel like as Americans, we have a lot. We have a lot of options. We've got this we can try or this we can try, and we can try all those different things, and then we're like, okay, God, like none of my stuff worked. My wisdom didn't work, so I'm going to go to you. That's backwards. We need to go to him first because he has the answers. He's the one that's going to give him the wisdom and what we need for whatever situation we're facing. So we need to pray first. We need to go to him and see what he has to say. There's a saying that says, let prayer be your steering wheel and not your spare tire. So let it direct you instead of pulling out something last minute, in a last-ditch effort. So we are called to pray, and I'm going to go through those scriptures, and I said, if you're doing this, pray. If this is happening, pray. If this is happening, pray. So the first one of those is we are called to pray if we are suffering. And this connects directly with Pastor Hollis's sermon last week about patience in suffering. We need to have patience in suffering, as he said, as James says, to keep trusting, to keep putting our faith, to keep waiting on God, knowing that he is there, he's moving, he's doing things even if we can't see it, and to continue to trust and to have faith and to put that faith into action. So it's important that in the waiting and the patience and in the suffering that we're not passive but active. So it's not just like, okay, I'm just going to sit here. I know I'm waiting for your answer. I'm just going to sit here and do nothing. We need to be active in our waiting. And one of those ways to be active is to pray and to continue to pray, to continue to trust, to continue to put our faith in God and do things to be active, and to invite others into our lives to do that life together. So I think there's a great example in the Bible when it comes to suffering. David in the Psalms, he went through a lot. He suffered a lot. He was honest with God, and it's good to be honest with God. He knows anyways, so be honest with him. He can handle it. And David was very honest and real in the Psalms. But even though he had troubling times, he suffered, he still always turned it back to God. He still gave God praise in the end and honored him and followed him. And so it's important. In our praying, we're communing with God. We're in his presence. We are finding and discovering his heart, his healing. We're releasing things. We're releasing pain. So there's a process that happens when we go to God in prayer. The word also says that we are to weep with those that weep. So if we are the body and we see people suffering, or we ourselves are suffering, we're supposed to weep with those who weep. Jesus even asked his disciples when he was going to the Garden of Gethsemane to have his disciples pray for him. So he was inviting people to prayer in his suffering, in his time of suffering. He was asking his disciples to pray, which didn't really turn out super well for him because he fell asleep. But even Jesus wanted that prayer support while he was going through suffering. If he wanted it, I know I want it. I need it. So we pray if we are suffering. It also says from verse 14 that we are called to pray if you're sick. It says, call the elders or the spiritual leaders to come and to pray and to anoint with oil. So there are a couple of things that stood out to me in this verse. The first one is that when it says, if you are sick, I automatically think, you have a disease, something physically that you're struggling with. But when you look at the word sick in Greek, it's the word kamno, and this word can also be translated as one who is weak, worn out, or faint. So if you're sick physically, yes, or in any other way, or if you're just weak and worn out, ask for prayer. Invite God into the situation, invite others into the situation to pray. And then the other thing that stood out to me was that there was an invitation to pray. And I think that's important. I think that's another active step that we can take. So if we're suffering or if we're sick, ask people, invite people into your life to do life with you, to know that they have your back, that they're going to be praying for you, that they're going to be encouraging you. That's inviting relationship. That's doing life together, not doing life alone. We need to invite others into our lives. Another time it says to pray is if we're struggling with sin, verses 15 and 16. 15 says that prayer offered in faith will make the sick or weak person well, and if they have sinned, they will be forgiven. And in 16 it says, confess your sins, pray, and you'll be healed. So the idea appears that there could be a connection between sin and sickness. So I don't think we ever really know. There are biblical examples where it does say that somebody was sick because of sin. In John 5 is an example of the healing of the invalid. And then also even through the communion script text that we normally go through, 1 Corinthians 11, that reads, whoever therefore eats the bread or drinks the cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty of concerning the body and blood of the Lord. Let a person examine himself then, and so eat the bread and drink of the cup. For anyone who eats and drinks without discerning the body eats and drinks judgment on himself. That is why many of you are weak and ill, and some have even died. So We need to examine ourselves. But then there's also examples in Scripture where it was not because of sickness or sin, I should say, why somebody was sick. John 9, Jesus healing the blind man. The disciples were asking him, so why is he blind? Was it his sin? Was it his parents' sin? Jesus says, no, it wasn't any of that. So, you know, we never really know. What we do know is that we do live in a fallen world where sin is present, where sickness is present, and we're going to be impacted by the presence of that in the world. But the most important thing is that it's to stay close in communion with God, in relationship with him, to stay connected, praying, asking for forgiveness, abiding in him, having the mind and the heart, our hearts renewed by his word, examining ourselves against the word. That is what is important. If we're struggling, go to God in prayer, invite people into your life, be honest with God, look, find that forgiveness that you need, the healing you need, whatever. He's got it. And the last point with prayer is that our prayer is to be earnest, heartfelt, persistent, passionate, fervent, and we're to pray continually. So the effectual prayer, it's not going to stop until the job is finished. I think sometimes where our prayers are not effectual is because we pray for 5 minutes, don't get an instant result, and we're like, okay, moving on. We quit. We're not supposed to do that. We keep praying. We pray without ceasing. And I think we can easily get discouraged if something doesn't happen right away. But we need to keep praying, keep pressing in, keep have faith. And also the fervent prayer, it's a prayer that's prompted by the Holy Spirit. Like, there's passion and fire and love. And if it means something to you, if what you're praying about means something to you, it's going to be passionate, it's going to be heartfelt, it's going to be earnest, and that is how we are to pray. Prayer in which your soul cries out to God. All right, point number two, moving on, finally, is we are called to praise. So, of course, I liked this one. Verse 13 says that if you're suffering, pray. If you're happy, if you're merry, if you're joyful, sing praises to God. I think this is just like I said for prayer, like we are to pray continually. I think in our worship, in our praise, it's not something that we do just when we're happy. We do it all the time. The Word of God says, Psalm 34:1, I will exalt the Lord at all times. His praise will continually be on my lips. So we are to praise whether we're happy or not. And we don't praise him because we're happy. We praise him because he's worthy of our praise. And that doesn't change. Our circumstances may change, but God doesn't change. He remains the same. He's constant. So we may be suffering. We may be sick, but God is still worthy to be praised. So we praise all the time. And then in connected with that, I think one of the reasons why it's important that we praise in this situation is because praise is truth declared. Praise is often a testimony set to song, and I think it can be evangelistic. So if there are people in our midst that are suffering, that are going through something, if I'm suffering, I need to see somebody who has gone through suffering or sickness and to see them praising God. I need that testimony that they have. I need that encouragement that they have. I need that truth that they have to be an encouragement to me. And I think that's another reason why praise is important. Why we need to always do that. All right, point number three is we are called to confess. So this is from verse 16 in James 5. So we are called to confess to one another our sins, our shortcomings, our weaknesses, our offenses, and pray. So I think in one instance, we might be confessing to somebody else, to one another, to each other. Maybe they have done something that has offended you, and you're in relationship and you're working that out. Or maybe you've done something to somebody and you know it was wrong, and you're going to them and saying, hey, I know this is wrong, I'm confessing to you. I think that's one instance where we need to have that relationship. We need to be honest, we need to be real with one another. We need to follow Matthew 18, where if somebody's offended you or sinned against you, you go to that person and you find that healing, you find that restoration in that relationship. And then even Matthew 5, it says to go and to be reconciled. So it's important that we go and we make things right with the people that we're in relationship with. And once you go and you confess and you're honest and you're real and you're loving and you're humble, healing can happen. Forgiveness can happen in that relationship. And it can be restored and you go on. And I think there's another reason why, so that's one example. Another reason is I think it's important is because we're the body. Again, and we need each other. I can't refuse to participate in life with the elbow, and I'm the hand, because I'm mad at the elbow. I'm offended by them. They hurt me. I can't fully function without being connected to them. So we need to find healing. We need to find that restoration in those relationships, if possible. Where it says, if at all possible, we are to live at peace with one another. So we try. We do our part, and God takes care of the rest. And then one other point with that is, another instance why we need that relationship, why we need that connection to confess to one another, is because we need accountability in our lives. We need people who will challenge us and encourage us in life to follow God, to pray for us as we struggle. I need and want people to hold me accountable to what I claim to profess and what God died for me to have and to live in. So I need you to hold me accountable. And you guys hopefully can hold each other accountable. We as the body are in relationship with one another and can hold each other accountable. Proverbs 27:17, the Bible says that iron sharpens iron. We need each other. We need to be refined and be in each other's lives, because we're gonna grow from that. We're gonna be better from that. And then Proverbs 27:6, it says, faithful are the wounds of a friend, which wounds hurt, but if they're their friend, they're doing it out of love and for your good. So it might hurt to hear your friend say, you know, you're really not following, you're off in this lane and you need to be over here. It might hurt, but it's for our good. So we need that relationship with one another in the body. All right. The last point is we are called to restore. And this is from verses 19 through 20. We as a body once again must remain together to stay connected to one another, because we are called to help and restore those who wander. We are called to community and to bring those back into community, because verses 19 and 20, it's somebody who was following God but now has wandered. So we need to invite them back, bring them back into the family. Galatians 6:10, Paul writes, brethren, if a man is overtaken in any trespass, you who are spiritual, restore such a one in a spirit of gentleness. That's what we're called to do. That's how we're called to live. And Colossians 3:14 says, and above all of these, put on love, which binds everything together in perfect harmony. We have to put on love. We have to walk in love, especially in those relationships where somebody's gone off on their own. We need to be filled with his grace, with his truth, with his love, with his words. And then 1 Peter 4:8 says, above all, love each other deeply, because love covers a multitude of sin. We have to walk in love, to talk in love, and to gently guide them back. So restoring people means we work with people. We who are spiritual are supposed to restore the weak. If we're going to do that, we need to remember that all people are going through battles, their own obstacles, their own tough times. And to restore people, we need to stick with them and not throw them away. You're struggling, I'm not going to deal with you anymore. No. In a spirit of gentleness, in a spirit of love, we try to bring them back into the family, into the community. We are to be ministers of his grace, his truth, his love, and to be ministers of reconciliation. We have the opportunity as believers to tell the world that they can be reconciled to God through Christ, and to help restore those who have allowed sin to creep into their lives, to remind them that their relationship with the Lord can be restored and that they are welcomed in. If you've fallen, it's okay. Get back up and we'll keep moving forward. The ministry of reconciliation is a big responsibility, and God is making his appeal through us as his people, as his ambassadors. The ministry we have been given is to help turn hearts toward God, So we have the call to restore those that knew God and were following him and are not, and those who have never followed him. We are to reach out. It's one of our goals, our values. So I'm going to invite the worship team up. So in conclusion, there are four main things that we are called to do. We are called to do these things individually, but we are also called to do them together as the body, to walk in faith together because we need each other. So I encourage you to pray. Pray if you're suffering. Pray if you're happy. Pray if you're sick. And pray for those who are suffering. Pray for others who are sick. Pray for those who are struggling with sin. Invite people into your life to do life with you and be honest. I encourage you to praise, whether you're happy or whether you're in a season of difficulty. God is worthy of our praise regardless. And like I said, praise is a testimony of what you've been through, and we need that testimony. We need that hope, that truth to be sung over us and to God. Number three, I encourage you to confess, to do life with other, invite people into your life. It can be a little scary, but we are called to do that. That's how we help each other. It's how we challenge each other. It's how we encourage one another and actually know how to pray for people, is by being in relationship with them. So confess to one another. Have that accountability. And the last is to restore. We're called to restore. So we need to have our eyes open, our hearts open. We have to be in relationship with people so that we can know where they're at, so that if we see them going off, I really need to know so that I can help to bring them back. And for those who never have known Jesus, we need to have our eyes open, our hearts open, and our mouths open to say something, to love on them, to invite them in life with me, with us. So that's my challenge for you. And let's be intentional and be obedient to what God has set before us. It's super practical. It's not always easy to do life with people, but we are called to be the body and we do need each other. So this week, whether it's today, tomorrow, sometime this week, pray about those different areas, about praying for those who are suffering or sick or in sin, about praising, about confessing to one another. You know, maybe you have had a relationship with somebody, and because of sin or because of unforgiveness, you're just not dealing with it anymore. And maybe there's unforgiveness or anger or bitterness in your heart, and you know it. If that's the case, pursue that relationship. Pursue that healing, that forgiveness. And then to restore others. If you know somebody who's going off the path, gently bring them back in. Love on them. Reach out in that relationship. So that's my encouragement, my challenge for us this week. And really every day, we're called to live this way. Let's do something about it. Let's walk it out together. So I'm going to pray for us. And there will be people, the pastors in the corners, if anybody does need prayer. We just talked about prayer and the importance of it. So if you are suffering, or you know somebody is, who's suffering or sick or struggling with sin, or relationships, whatever, financially, emotionally, mentally, spiritually. We all have stuff we go through that we struggle with. They're here to pray for you. So if you need prayer, take that step of faith and ask for prayer. Partner with people. Invite people into your situations, into life, and do life together. So I'm going to have them sing this song. So let's just engage our hearts together. The song is "Great Are You, Lord," and I feel like it talks about every single part, every single point. It talks about restoring. It talks about hope. It talks about his love. And so let's just worship him, think upon him, pray to him. Let's just pay attention to him and what he's saying right now. So.
You bring light to me. Our hearts will cry in these bones, they'll sing.
Thank you, Lord, for who you are. And God, we thank you, Lord, for what you've done in our lives and what you're continuing to do in our lives, God. We thank you, Lord, that you do restore, that you bring hope, that you bring light to darkness. God, that you bring life to us. God, and we want to honor you with our lives. We want to follow you. We want to walk in faith. We want to walk in obedience to what you've set before us, God. And we thank you, Lord, that we are not alone, but that you are with us, God, and that you've placed us in a body of believers to walk and to do life with, Lord. Pray, Lord, that you would help us to walk in obedience to that, God, to take advantage of that body that you've placed in our lives, God, to pray, to encourage, to challenge one another in you. So we thank you, God. May you have your way in our lives. May you have your way in this church, in this community, God. We love you, God. We want to honor you. And so we pray these things in your name. Amen. All right. Well, thank you for joining us. And we'll see you next week. God bless.